Welcome on this new edition of Tête à Tête on Télé-Creole. Once again, Charles Lucien, for this special program where we'll have a chance to interview two guests in the context of some very interesting, some very important cultural events that will take place throughout the months of April and the month of May of 2015, Haitian Heritage Month. Our first guest is Lindsay Day from Northeastern University. And we are going to discuss something that is going to sound surprising to my guest. So first, let me say welcome on Tête à Tête on Télé-Creole.
Merci. Bonjour.
Oh, do you want to continue in French or Creole?
No, thank you. But I thought I'd throw it in there.
So you are at Northeastern University. You are part of the public history program.
Yes.
Can you briefly describe to us what this program is at Northeastern University?
Absolutely. So the public history program is focused on teaching upcoming professionals how to work in museums and nonprofit organizations. So we are looking to look at how history is portrayed to the public and take it outside of solely academic world and try to engage the public further on. And we're prepared to work in all sorts of different kinds of institutions and examining how what the best methods are for engaging the public in learning about history beyond what we already know.
Now, I'm not that familiar with that field. Public history,
yeah.
Is it a more recent type of field?
It's been developing since the museum world started to become more professional. So back in the day when people started collecting art and artifacts, there were these things called mystery cabinets of mystery mm-hmm. and wonder. And they developed into what I would say is the modern day art museum, like the MFA. So we learn about how to portray art in museum spaces like the MFA. Mm-hmm. And now public history has expanded to different kinds of museum spaces, like the Museum of Science, where there's a lot of interactive aspects when you visit the museum. And there's also house museums, a lot in Boston and the New England area specifically, that kind of take you into a time warp and you kind of put yourself in the space of what it was like to be in the 1700s when there was settlements in the area and that sort of thing. So the public history field has developed a lot and changed a lot. And is continuing to develop, especially with the technology boom. And that's created a lot of different opportunities for people like me.
And again, let me share with my viewers here that from this conceptual piece talking about this academic field, mm-hmm. we are literally talking about an event that will take place this coming Sunday, mm-hmm. The 12th of April, between 4 and...
It's a 5 and 7.
5 and 7?
Yes.
In Wilkes-Barre, that will be something that's open to the public.
Totally open to the public.
And this is about the concept of confronting Guantanamo.
Yes. So my public history cohort came into our program last year, and we learned about the history of the U.S. Naval Base at Guantanamo. And we were learning about it because of a project that was developed in New York at Columbia University, where they put together an exhibit of photos and text that explained this long history. And the focus of that exhibit was to ask questions of the audience of what they think about the US presence at Guantanamo and how we use the space and how it affects legal questions and the people that stay there, soldiers and people who ended up being detained there in the early 1990s through to the present day. So we learned about this history, and we contributed to the project and the exhibit by collecting oral history interviews and doing research on the Haitian refugee crisis of the early 1990s. So that's how we got interested in the project. Mm-hmm. And then when our class was over, we wanted to bring the exhibit that they developed to Northeastern. So we did. It's at Northeastern now, and it's open to the public 24/7 in one of our residence halls at 1155 Tremont Street. So that exhibit is up. It poses questions about the history of Guantanamo, and we added Creole translations to it because
impressive.
We specifically wanted to target the Haitian and Haitian American communities in Boston to continue talking about this history that I believe has been overshadowed by the current controversies at Guantanamo.
Mm-hmm. Let me backtrack a little bit. You mentioned mm-hmm. a collection of oral stories about
yes.
it. How did it happen? Was that a process? In what language?
So we did them in English. We found local members of, I specifically interviewed a woman named Deborah Anker. She is a law professor at Harvard, and she testified in the legal cases that were brought against the United States government in the early 90s due to the improper detention of Haitian refugees at Guantanamo. So we interviewed her about that process and the legal ramifications of the court cases. So we collected that interview, and then we put it into a documentary that did a more of an overview of the history, breaking it down, making it more accessible. And that video is now online at the Guantanamo Public Memory Project archive mm-hmm. online. It's a gitmomemory.org.
Now, why is it important to document the history of Guantanamo on one hand, mm-hmm. and then second, of Haitians who were in Guantanamo, particularly between the years of 1991-1994?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So we really want to talk about the history of Guantanamo because I believe that a lot of the current controversies detract from the long history that the U.S. has had there. The U.S. established the naval base in 1898 mm-hmm. and has had a century of history impacting the Caribbean world and that sort of thing. So we wanted to expand the general knowledge on our presence there. And we really wanted to focus on the Haitian refugee crisis specifically because at the time, it took years for the press to even get there and acknowledge the voices that were there and wanting to be heard. And a lot of them were sent back to Haiti because they didn't want to wait at Guantanamo anymore, not knowing why they weren't being accepted into the U.S.
Right. So when you are referring to current or present controversies, mm-hmm. I assume that you are referring to the fact that President Obama has been going through some kind of a struggle to get these bases to be closed.
Yes.
Or there have been people who've been jailed or imprisoned over there, sometimes for good reasons, sometimes for reasons that reveal to be totally...
Totally not there at all. Like, right. they don't have any evidence on why a particular individual is there.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's stemming from this history where Haitians were detained at Guantanamo. Nobody committed any crimes. There was no reason why they were in a space that was like a prison. And the perspectives on the issue are wide because the military, a lot of representatives of the military say that they put together this humanitarian space as quickly as they could and accommodated as many people as they could, and they didn't think that they could do any additional help.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's other researchers and people there reporting on how horrible the conditions were. So we want to highlight the different perspectives, basically get as many stories told as possible, especially those that weren't heard at the time.
Are there particular stories or episodes or anecdote that you discovered as you were doing those interviews or investigation that are particularly striking?
Mm. So when we were doing our investigation, I was mostly excited by listening to Deborah Anker talk about the legal controversy. But I was particularly excited afterwards when I went to a conference on Guantanamo hosted by Brown in the fall. And they had one of our current speakers at our April 18th event.
Mm-hmm.
She was there, and she told her story of being a translator. So she was Haitian American. She went down to Guantanamo to translate for as many Haitian detainees as she could to try to get their voices heard and get them through to the U.S. as quickly as possible. And she reported on being very overwhelmed and upset by the fact that she couldn't help more people. Mm-hmm. So I thought her story was particularly striking, and she is back. She's in the U.S. Hosting or co-founded a nonprofit in New York called Haitian Women for Haitian Refugees. So she has continued a great history of civic engagement and trying to help as many people as she can. So I wanted her story to continue to be heard and make sure that what she experienced there gets heard now.
Nous rappelons soir sur le programme ça que NAPE recevoir l'NCD, il fait partie d'un groupe étudiant dans Northeastern University qui dans Roxbury cap travaille sur un projet les Confronting Guantanamo qui gagne pour avec expérience que les Haïtiens dépassés dans base Guantanamo dans commencement des années 90 particulièrement entre 1990 91 et 1994 et il y a une exhibition qui pourrait les faire dans date capée 12 avril entre 5h et 7h dans Roxbury. Nous allons prendre plus de détails encore, nous encourageons tout le monde pour prend attention, mais prêtez attention, puis qu'à participer. Did you get it?
A little bit. I heard some numbers in there.
That's correct. Now, tell me about the group of students or your colleagues who became part of it. I'm trying to understand what's their background, what's their motivation. Mm-hmm. Have they all been interested into history as a field and that brought them together around this particular project?
Yes, so we are actually all interested in different things. A few of my classmates are interested in actually writing the exhibit labels that you see at museums. Mm-hmm. Others are more interested in dealing with the actual stuff that goes into museums and making sure it's preserved properly. Another one of our cohort is, she's specifically interested in putting exhibits up and the design of them. Mm-hmm. So we came together with all of our backgrounds on how to put an exhibit together and how to publicize it. That was an interesting story for us of trying to figure out how to do publicity when none of us came from a real marketing background. But we luckily had the wonderful help of James Pierre, who one of our advisors connected us with, and he has fantastic experience as a community organizer and has been consulting us on this project throughout our time since, about November. Right. And he's done great work.
Now, as you present this exhibit, what would we have to expect for the Haitian community? I see that there are opportunities to get into dialogue, but what are some of the expectations for people attending?
I think I really want to, for as many young people as possible of the younger generations of the communities to learn about this history and also find out about how they learned about it in the past, if they have or not. Mm-hmm. I think most have, but just expanding on the details and giving some of the specifics of what it was like there. So then we can talk about how civic engagement in the present day and getting more involved politically in nonprofits, that sort of thing. I want to kind of get that conversation going and talk about how we can encourage people with the stories of what our speakers have done up to this point and how they've gotten involved in the Boston community and made it stronger and how younger generations can continue to contribute to that.
Now, evoking, confronting Guantanamo clearly is going to bring out all kind of dark moments.
Yes.
Possibly shameful episodes in the history of civil rights here in the U.S., possibly evoke instances of discrimination or racism. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to understand, how do you view approaching or raising those kind of issues in this particular context, one? And is there some kind of, are there some kind of guidelines or some kind of limitations from an academic standpoint, either from the leadership of the school or from your, if you have any counselors? So trying to understand, A, dealing with all those issues, and then B, what's the role of Northeastern or any advisor that you have in surrounding or guiding you through this?
Mm-hmm. So I recently read a quote in a book that I was reading for class, and it was a book on the public history of slavery and talking about a very difficult history and how we portray that in museum spaces. And one of the great quotes that I loved was, a useful history is one that shows the painful as well as the prideful moments. So that's preparing us to not ignore our shameful past, mm-hmm. to not cover it up and act like it's not there. So that's a big part of why we confronted Guantanamo the way that we did and want to do at our events. We understand that there's going to be tough stuff talked about. Mm-hmm. And we really want to focus on providing a space for those topics to be discussed and faced, and then to try to tell stories that will help people feel like they can come together as a community that has had the shared experience and will overcome the injustice that was done. Like, will, without question.
Right. And as you are saying this, I'm thinking also that this is happening in the context of what's currently taking place in Ferguson, mm-hmm. in New York, and so many black lives mm-hmm. have been under troubling circumstances wasted or eliminated. Has any connection been made with what's happening now?
I think that's a big part of why I think we can do this sort of event. I don't think a lot of people would be interested in talking about a painful history if they didn't feel like anything was going to come out of it. Mm-hmm. But I think now is the perfect time because, one, President Obama, he's talked about really forcing the closure of Guantanamo to come sooner, especially with the recent better relations between Cuba and the U.S. Mm-hmm. So this is a perfect time to talk about Guantanamo. And in that same opportunity, we can expand that conversation and make sure that all of as many issues as we have can be talked about. So that's why we really wanted to engage the community. We also will not, the exhibit will come down in April, so we wanted to do this while we still have it.
Let me make sure that we repeat again, and we'll have to do that from time to time. Again, the address and mm-hmm. time of the specific event we are mentioning.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So we have our first event is on April 12th. It's at the Haley House Bakery in Roxbury, and it starts at 5 o'clock. And that's when we'll show a short documentary that my classmate Sarah Hudson and I created last semester, or in the fall. And then we'll be opening the floor for a conversation based on viewing that documentary. And we just want some mingling and socializing around some larger open-ended questions.
Right. Now, any of your colleagues or classmates had a chance to visit either Cuba or Haiti at some point, or plans?
unfortunately not, but the plans, I will say, are in the works, mm-hmm, especially mm-hmm. for me. This project has been very enlightening for me to continue my research on Haiti as a nation, and I've done a few visits with different community members, and they always ask me, have you been to Haiti? When are you going to Haiti? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And now I'm like, oh, that's something I want to do. And I want to continue my research. I just have to figure out if it's going to be academic or if it can be in another way. I kind of want to lean the other way and do some nonprofit work.
Just sharing with you, I literally just came from a viewing of a series of short films made by young amateur Haitian filmmakers, but under the supervision of a veteran filmmaker, Michael Sheridan, who's been to Afghanistan, who's been to Haiti.
Oh, man.
And as we speak now, they are showing those movies in Jamaica Plain and raising the kind of discussions you are alluding to about the role of the international community, role of the U.S. Mm-hmm. in what's happening in Haiti and the relationship to here.
That's great.
Right.
Yeah.
Now, are there any young Haitian or Haitian Americans in the group that's currently working with you?
Unfortunately not, but we have made some great contacts throughout the last few months, and our the UMass Boston president of the Haitian Student Union is going to be at our event on Sunday, and he's making his best effort to make it, and we really want to bring him over because he also said the Haitian Student Union at Northeastern, unfortunately, has been inactive. We were unable to make connections with them in the last year, but But Ted from UMass Boston said he'd come over and help us make some more connections as well. So.
Right. So tell me about the exhibit itself. Mm-hmm. You mentioned earlier what was taking place in New York consisted in both imagery mm-hmm. and text.
Yes.
Who literally took those pictures, and what was the mm-hmm. selection process, and the text themselves on display? Mm-hmm. Who created them? What was the editing or selection process?
So this exhibit was put together by actually quite a few universities. So there were different public history programs that did history or did research on the history of Guantanamo. And a lot of the photos are from the United States Coast Guard Archive. Mm-hmm. So they're all fully accessible to the public. So they selected photos, and the way that they chose what photos and text to write was based on these larger questions that they wanted to use to provoke dialogue. So an example is, what is a refugee and what makes a refuge? And then, so then behind that is a large picture of the Haitian refugee camp that was then used for Cuban migrants as well in 1994, 1995. Mm-hmm. And then there's a history on how, the text is a history on how Guantanamo suddenly became a space for refugee camps mm-hmm. when it was usually just used as a naval base for soldiers and the small town that was created around that base. So there were multiple universities that put this together, and the leader was Columbia University.
Columbia, right.
Yeah.
And as we go through this again, not having seen the exhibit myself, mm-hmm. has the name of, for example, Edwige Dantica, if you know this name, came about?
I don't recognize it.
Right.
Yes.
Famous Haitian-American writer.
Okay.
Big time. And one of the books that she wrote that has to do with her own family traces a particularly painful episode of a family member of hers who actually went through the Guantanamo experience.
Wow.
So those kind of things usually further expose the situation. Mm. The other thing I was thinking when they say Guantanamo, you did mention that this piece started in Cuba in 1898.
Eight.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Sorry, 1880.
1898.
That's correct.
Yes.
We also found that at some point, the initial place where the base was supposed to be was in Haiti.
Yes. Yes, I did. I found that out recently, too.
Wonderful. Uh-huh.
And at the time, or I think it was a little bit before 1898, that the Haitian government, or what was it, they restricted foreign purchase of the land, mm-hmm. so the U.S. couldn't go there. And they actually only got the base at Guantanamo because of the victory over the Spanish in the Spanish-American War, which was pretty swift. But yeah, the Haiti rejected the U.S. Presence there, and
right.
rightfully so, until there was U.S. occupation in, like, 1913.
19, yeah, right, 15.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. So this is just to say again, that's a powerful thing to share.
Oh, yeah.
If people can discuss this whole history of Frederick Douglass was the one mm-hmm. who actually was in charge of negotiating the sale of a part of Haiti, and then apparently he colluded one of the Haitian foreign minister mm-hmm. to prevent this from happening, which led to the U.S. actually moving to Cuba mm-hmm. to make it happen. So we do anticipate people to get fully involved into the discussion if we are able to bring this part of our history mm-hmm. as well as part of the exhibition. Mm-hmm. So let me know about the outreach that's happening now in the community, besides Télé Créole, other places where we are, you are reaching out to make sure that people get the word.
Yes, yes. We just, this past Sunday, we were on the WMBR Haiti Focus show in the morning. Jean-June, he interviewed myself and James Pierre. Uh-huh. And we had some good callers as well. I was very excited about that. We had someone call in who all of the phone calls were in Creole, so I couldn't understand everything. But one of the callers was actually from, used to be at Northeastern in the 90s and had protested as a part of the Haitian Student Union for larger awareness of what was happening at Guantanamo. And he gave us his email over the phone, and it was so great. I was very excited about it. I'm still waiting to hear back, but it was a great connection to make. And then upcoming soon, I'm still making the arrangements, but we're also going to be getting the word out through a couple of interviews with Teleboston as well. I made a connection with Gary Zizi, and he set us up.
Oh, Zizi is full of energy and can get things out. And before I end, I wanted to understand something that I raised before. Mm-hmm. At the level of the school, mm-hmm. is there any kind of support, morally, intellectually, to see you moving forward with this project? Are there advisors for this to happen? Mm-hmm.
So we have had the wonderful support of our city and community affairs office. Mm-hmm. The vice president, John Tobin, and another vice president, Dave Eisberg. He has supported our event financially, but also will be attending our April 18th event, mm-hmm. so to help make more connections with the university to get support out to organizations outside of the university.
Superb. Let's take again date of the main events and addresses where they'll take place, and also if there are ways to contact you either via social media or via phone, whatever.
Absolutely. So our first event is April 12th. That's this Sunday at 5 o'clock at the Haley House Bakery in Roxbury.
And do you have the address?
Oh, it's a.
We'll pass it. We'll.
Sorry about that. Mm-hmm. But our second event is on Saturday, April 18th, and that's at 1155 Tremont Street, mm-hmm. on Northeastern's campus, where we'll have the exhibit and then our speaker panel after viewing the exhibit with
Q&A attendees. With the audience.
Yes.
Wonderful.
Yes. And that starts at 2 o'clock.
Social media, how to?
Well, our Facebook page is called Confronting Guantanamo, mm-hmm. and our two events are labeled the Haitian Experience at Guantanamo. One is a neighborhood event, Haley House, mm-hmm. and one is a community event at Northeastern on the 18th.
Thank you very much, Lindsay.
Thank
that
you so
was
much
great
for
conversing
having
me. With you about this. It's a powerful, it's an interesting and topic. And I definitely hope that our viewers will make a choice to attend either the 12th or the 18th at Northeastern. C'était avec nous encore une fois, l'INCD qui a pu parler nous de l'activité ça qui a pu faite par les étudiants de Northeastern qui fait partie du Public History Program qui a été mis en évidence sur ce qui a passé à Guantanamo avec un focus spécial sur Haïti. Rappelons encore deux dates, c'est le 12 avril entre 5h et 7h et deuxièmement le 18 avril entre between April 18th between,
April 18th is at 2 p.m.
2 p.m., 2h de l'après-midi. Mm-hmm. C'est avec Charles Lucien pour notre édition de Tête à Tête sur Télé-Créole. Était branché pour prochain invité, nous qui parlons de Kounia là. Merci beaucoup.
Merci.